Welcome back to our Comicgeddon Beginner's Guide series, where we dive deep into the world of collecting and tell you everything you need to know to get started with your collections. And as always, if you enjoy this video, make sure to subscribe for more content. Also hit the like button and give us a thumbs up and leave your comments below. Hey guys, welcome back to Comicgeddon. Right now we're getting ready to go over a beginner's guide to comic book collecting.
Yes. A lot of people, they'll come into the store, they'll want to sell their comics here, which is fine. I always encourage that. I also encourage donations. But they want, they already have a price in mind, which again is okay, but typically it's the price they see on eBay, and it's, you can't really go by eBay prices.
Right.
And if they
don't, there was a sandwich on eBay that looked like Elvis Presley that sold for like $1,000 or something like that.
Right. Or they have a stack of old books that they think are worth something. They don't do research. They come in thinking, oh, these are old. These are worth money. And a lot of times, if you want to go grab Archie up there, it has no cover. Or the Jughead behind it works, too. So they'll bring in old books. And a lot of times, now they'll look like this. You can see the cover is really, it's not there. But it's old, so it must be worth some money, right? So... and the back, definitely show the back. Yeah. So, not necessarily the case. A lot of times I'll get books like this, or books like this, for instance, which isn't necessarily in bad shape, but, it, you know, it's not going to be worth $20, $100, $50. In the case of this one's $3. So, research is kind of key. Knowing what to look for is also key. So
let's start with this one since it's...
Well, okay. I'll tell you what. What I'm going to do, when you bring me your books, this, and I always walk the customers through this. This is what you look for. I'm going to open this up. Okay. So this book... not really too bad shape. Okay. So, the first thing I'm going to look at when I take it and look at your book, I'm going to ask you if I can remove it from the back and board if it has one. I do this so I can actually look at the overall book. And you've noticed how I'm handling it. Okay, I'm not taking it, I'm not handling it like this, I'm not flipping it around like that. You know, I'm not doing any of that. I'm... So, I'm handling it very carefully. Very delicate. So the things you're going to want to look for, first off, or I look for the corners here. Typically, the sharper the corners, the better. Front and back. Look at the bottom here. I look for creases in the spine. And if you flip it over, if it's been read a lot, you're going to have a long white lines along the edges of the spine.
Like this here.
Exactly. That means it's been read a lot, it's been opened a lot.
It's been flattened out most likely.
Yeah.
That's how you get the white line, is mainly when they flatten it out. Because if you keep it like this, it doesn't really get that too often.
And here's how I typically read a book, read a comic. And I always encourage reading a comic book. I don't open the comic all the way. And again, comics, and I will say this till the day I die, comics are meant to be read, okay? But if you're a collector, this is kind of how you want to handle them a bit. If you're a real hardcore collector, you'll wear gloves. But I'm not that kind of collector.
No.
Mine are in good, I keep mine in as best shape as possible, which is why I always keep them in a bag and board. But if I'm going to read them, I'm going to take them out, and I'm going to read them. I'm not going to worry about gloves. But gloves are an option. So now you're going to want to open the book and you want to see how white the pages are. And you can see these pages are actually kind of white. They're pretty good shape. See if there's any coupons taken out. So a lot of times though, you're going to get pages that aren't so white. And that's just because of age. Also,
on this side, so you have to bring it closer.
Say, you can see the edges, or you know. Something else to keep in mind, if you're in a home, a smoker's home, if this book smells like smoke, I'm not taking it. Collectors don't like their comic book smelling like tobacco. So, kind of, you know, kind of a downside to being a smoker living in a smoker's house, unfortunately. Sometimes you'll get comic books. I've seen this a lot. They'll have creases right here because the page has been folded. Pages inside will have the same crease because, you know, you get people who read them and they want to mark their page.
And another thing to look for is on the cover, specifically on the back cover, is a lot of times the older comics won't have boards, and sometimes people double up comics.
Don't do that.
And the ink will actually leave an impression, like with this board here. I don't know if you can see through the plastic or not.
Take it out. It is good to maybe every 10 years or so switch out your boards.
Right. See that? It's kind of
yellowish.
Yeah. Some of my older comics, I can actually make out exactly.
Yeah. Now, it doesn't really damage the comic so much. It's just pretty much the board. Something else, like this comic here is worth $3. I go on comicpriceguide.com, and there is a rating scale there. Once you get good at looking over comics and everything, you can kind of get an idea of the grading scale. If you don't know numbers, it has mint condition, near mint, fine, good, poor, and you can get an idea.
This would be considered
poor.
Very poor.
I would.
I've seen some. There's poor, and then there's bad, and very bad. And
on a point scale, this would be a 0.05, which I, you know. So, on that scale, it'd be worth like maybe 3 cents, 5 cents. Typically, books like this with covers hanging off, if on that scale, it's not worth at least $2 or $3. I throw it in the freebie bin. I have a free roll rack with some free comics on it. They're in that kind of a condition. Some of them don't have covers.
Pages hanging off.
Like this page, this isn't even connected. No. It's just. So this book, again, wouldn't even be, you know,
worth a dollar. Some comics like that.
I still do. I have a Morbius comic book like this. It's like issue 2. That's the only reason why I haven't gotten rid of it. So that's condition wise.
Right.
I don't think I'm really missing anything. It's pretty going over the basics here. So that's what you're looking for condition wise.
Let's go over something real quick. Now we did mention.
I missed something. Go ahead.
We did mention the crease and the spining. Now other than that, this comic here is still in pretty good condition. Other than maybe at the very bottom where you can see it's been pulled in
you
and out
show
of.
Show them that there. You can show that it's yeah. been.
The bottom,
worn.
Top and bottom, a little bit worn. You can tell it's been in and out of either a plastic bag or a cardboard box.
Or it could have been somewhere sticky.
Yeah. But other than that, it's not in very bad condition. I would say this would probably be good condition.
Good or on a scale of 4. Scale of 4 or 5.
Now, a mint comic, sharp edges, nowhere along the binding
almost off the press,
right?
And those are the ones that tend to be worth a little more. Now the books that you're if you're looking as like if you're a collector the books and if you or if you want to bring in your comics to comics to really look for comics from the 60s to I'd say early maybe middle 80s. After that, comic books kind of they're just not worth as much as you would think.
And like here, you see some comics have the staples.
Bent.
Some even have the staples in the bindings.
Yeah.
See this, the staples are almost pulled out of there. So this would probably be poor.
And the spine is bent.
Right.
I would, well, let's see. If it's still attached.
I think it is attached.
It is. It's very attached. It's still very readable. But this, as you can see, the comic itself is just it's dirty. It wasn't taken care of. It's been probably sitting in somebody's box. You can see the pages here.
If it did have plastic, it was probably doubled up.
Bag and boarded, I probably would grade this a 3. Because it is still very readable, so very collectible. The pages, you can see, are actually yellowed. So, probably also came from a smoking home. Definitely came from a smoking home. You can smell it.
But with comics that are old like this, it is very difficult to find a comic that
is a near mint like that.
Right. That doesn't have some discoloration in the pages.
Yeah.
Because back then they used a different type of paper they didn't use the high gloss paper that we get today.
No.
This was basically newspaper paper that they used.
Pretty much.
And even different inks they used on this.
Right. And books like this now, that I would consider a 3, I would look on the grading scale. I see, okay, Captain Marvel issue 43, I graded a 3. Oh, it's worth less than a dollar, but it's still in pretty decent shape. I'll put that in the dollar box. So, won't waste bag and boards on it. Just because the bag and boards together would cost,
Right.
So, that's pretty much the basics as far as condition.
Next, we'll go over what kind of comics to start collecting if you're a beginner. Stay tuned.
So, we just went over the basics of what to look for in conditions. If you have any questions about that, please feel free to comment. Message, So now, what kind of comics?
Right. Get started with? My brother just recently got into comics after years of watching the movies and the TV series. He decided he wanted to get into it. He didn't know where to start. Well, so obviously, right off the bat, he decided to get into DC Universe Rebirth, which isn't a bad place to start.
No, they just started rebranding the books again. So, but say for instance you've never seen any of the movies, okay, you've strayed away from it. Too much hype, you're not into it, maybe you're just not a fan of movies, your best bet is what do you like. When I say that, I mean, are you a smart aleck?
Deadpool would be the way to go.
Spider-Man, right. Iron Man,
Constantine.
Are you somebody who likes crossovers? Are you somebody who likes to see a bunch of superheroes together? Then you got Avengers, Justice League,
Brave and the Bold,
Teen Titans.
Brave and the Bold, if you guys don't know, Brave and the Bold started out as a Batman team-up book, but it kind of branched out into any two superheroes.
Right, with Batman essentially moving away from the Justice League and making his own team. My suggestion to you is go to your local comic book shop and ask the guy, hey, what's selling? What's hot? And maybe buy one issue of his suggestion. Or, I like the way this guy looks. I started by, this is a cool cover. Mm-hmm. I'll check this
out. Same with me.
Covers gets a lot of people into comic books. I knew nothing about Spider-Man when I started collecting. Spider-Man, the Fox Spider-Man cartoon had yet come out when I started collecting.
Here is a black cover Batman. A lot of people would probably be directed towards this simply because, Metallica's Black Label.
Go ahead and a little closer there. That's what reminds me. It looks like Metallica's Black Label. You can see that there's still a cover there. There's still embroidered pictures and everything like that on there. It's just pretty much a solid black. It looks cool. Again, why is somebody holding a gun to Batman's head? You want to know. A good way to do that, pick up the issue, open it up.
Another one that I saw this last week, I thought it would be good. I thought about buying it myself. It's not a very expensive comic, but you have the Sons of Batman and Superman.
Yeah.
I thought that was kind of cool. So
hold that one up and I'll just move the camera. Yeah. So here's one that depicts the classic 90s X-Men team. They're on their way to battle. This is one of those type of covers that had multiple covers that you can put together.
Can I open this up and show them?
It doesn't have the whole picture.
Oh, it didn't?
No.
I know one of mine had the whole thing.
Yeah, that's just one of those. Okay. So, and this is cool because this cover, there were like, I think, four or five different issue ones with different covers, and you could piece them together to form one picture. So that could be your start into, you know, collecting comics.
Another way to get started would be to go with, start out with the pulp comics and see if you like that kind of direction.
Yeah.
Pulp comics would be something like, say, the Green Hornet and Kato.
Right.
Where the heroes carried guns, the Phantom, the Shadow.
Maybe you're starting really late in life and you're like, you know, I remember listening to Green Hornet radio or watching the Green Hornet TV series. I wonder, are there any comic books of those? There are Green Hornet. There is.
Or if you grew up watching Westerns, there are Western comics.
There are Western books. We have, well, if you're a kid of the 80s and you liked G.I. Joe or Transformers, there are comics of those. So
most kids in the 90s really got into the Maximum Carnage from Spider-Man.
Yeah.
They got into the Clone Saga from Spider-Man.
Again, covers is a huge, huge thing. So if a certain cover catches your eye, like, you know, there's a hero, but the villain, that villain looks really cool. He looks super cool. I'm going to check out his story. So you grab that issue and you start.
Or you could even get into comic book adaptations of the movies.
Right.
Which here we have. X-Men the movie, the comic book adaptation, which is one of how I got into really deep into comics.
Yes, yeah. A lot of my first comics were movie adaptations. Like I have, a customer just came in looking for any comics based on the mask from the movie. There were two issues of that from Dark Horse Comics. I actually have those. Star Trek, I think Star Trek 4, I have that adaptation. I've got Superman 4, The Quest for Peace, Don't Judge. So
one thing I highly recommend when starting off in comics is getting one of the trade paperbacks. What a trade paperback is
they can be pricey, but yeah.
It's an entire collection of stories from a certain series like this one. Is this Tower of Babel?
No.
No. Is this just...
It's just Volume 3.
Okay.
Actually, the story might actually be... See, certain books don't always tell you what the storyline is, but you can they'll usually tell you what issues are right in here. Like this one collects issues, JLA issues 18 through 31.
There you go.
So.
And this would be this looks like it would probably be a late 90s, early 2000 story, right?
I'll tell you.
Well, I know.
It will tell you.
And usually on the first, either on the inside of the cover.
The copyright page.
Or the second page.
Yeah. Well, this collected came out in 2012, but those issues, issue 18 through 31, came out in 98 and 99. So, but the collected here came out in 2012.
And a good way, for DC Comics, for Justice League, a good way to tell what year the Justice League comic came out is take a look at Aquaman and Green Lantern. Let me show you. The mid to late 90s had a thing. They redesigned most of their heroes. Green Lantern was a completely different person. Kyle Rayner, he had a completely different uniform than what we were used to. Aquaman, he had a hook hand. He got rid of the orange shirt.
Yeah.
Became more barbarian-esque.
Almost, yeah.
So
more warlike.
And also, Flash. This is the Wally West Flash. I've mentioned this a few times in other videos.
Was still dead at that time, yeah.
And how you know it's the Wally West Flash is Barry had a solid lightning bolt running from side to side, going across his belt line, and he had the did he have the lightning bolt ears, right?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Whereas Wally has more of the wing ear pieces, and he's got more of the double bolt things coming to a connection in the middle.
So there are multiple ways that you can get into comics. Again, if you're not sure what you like, if you just, you know, oh, the cover looks cool, but I'm just not sure, ask your local comic book shop guy. He can tell you exactly what's hot, what's not. He may even have some choices he likes that he can try passing on to you.
Which right now I'm starting to get into, and I recommended this to my brother, Project Superpowers from Dynamite Comics. Very good series. It focuses on a lot of the Golden Age and Silver Age heroes that kind of fell off the face of the earth.
Yeah. Much.
Silver Star, who isn't part of Project Superpowers, but he's in Dynamite Comics, one of Jack Kirby's lost characters.
Right. There's even a character called Daredevil, or the Daredevil. So.
No, he's the death-defying devil.
No, the death-defying devil. Well, there was a... And Shannon just bought a comic.
The death-defying devil. He doesn't talk much. He's kind of a mysterious character in the comics. Dressed in red and black. Kind of like Two-Face, almost.
Yeah. So, mine, for instance, Green Lantern, Spider-Man, Wolverine. I love Doctor Strange even before the movie. She-Hulk. How are they? Even though, see, that's something else, too. Shannon agrees. Even if you've heard of these characters, like Spider-Man, Wolverine, Green Lantern, maybe some of the characters you haven't heard of, like She-Hulk, Spider-Woman, Hawk and Dove,
exactly,
Blue Beetle, Booster Gold. Some of these are even really cool characters that you might be interested in.
People just don't really give them a chance because they're familiar with the more...
They're not, you know, A-list characters.
Right. And like Invincible... I remember when this character first came out.
Yeah.
They did, Image did a digital comic that you could read on their website of his first issue before they released it. And it was actually really good. He got his name kind of like in the Spider-Man movie where Aunt May says, "You're not Superman, you know," and Peter just kind of looks at her like.
There was that kind of a moment.
There was that moment where his principal tells him, "You're not invincible, you know," and he's like,
hey, invincible, yeah.
But he's a very popular character right now, so.
So, I mean, that's really, I mean, we can keep talking about, you know, who we like and what we think you should like, but definitely, you know, go check, you know, go look for yourself.
And make sure when you buy comics, always put them in bags and boards. Don't just bag it, make sure it's bags and boards.
Because even though if you intend on reading them, it's always still good to keep them in good condition.
Yeah.
If you can get them to read them, you can get them to say, okay, I'm never going to open this, I'm never going to read it. I want to save it because it might be worth something someday. If that's the case, buy two. Because again, comic books are meant to be read. Right. Buy two. Buy one to read, buy one to save.
Now let's talk a little bit about the crash of the comic book.
Yeah. So, well, there was two. There were two crashes here. We had the early, 50s, 60s, I think it was 40s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, comic books like Superman were big. Mm-hmm. Of course, Wonder Woman, Batman. Marvel hadn't really come out, had established themselves yet.
Right. And those comics are probably the most valuable because at that time,
well,
there was World War II going on.
Well, there's other reasons besides that.
Good.
Because you also had another company called EC Comics. EC Comics was known for comic books called Tales from the Crypt, Vault of Horror. These really gritty, gruesome horror comics. There was a gentleman who created a book called Seduction of the Innocent, who pointed out that, you know, these are books are corrupting the youth. So a lot of these parents read this book and they burned and threw away a lot of their kids' comics. Which is why issues like Superman and Action Comics and Batman and Detective Comics, their first appearances, are worth so much.
Exactly.
And then in that was kind of the first comic book crash right there.
Right.
The second one came in the 90s.
With the death of Superman.
The death of Superman was announced, and it was such a big deal.
Even though he had actually died a few times before that.
Yeah, but kind of unceremoniously.
Yeah.
Like, this was more of a, you know... This was advertised as the official final, you know, which we knew that wasn't going to be, you know, it. And this was my first big comic book event.
Mine too.
So this, you know, I was super excited. Well, what happened was, DC had printed up so many copies of the Death of Superman run. Comic book stores were literally getting like full truckloads of just that one book, just that one issue, not including all the other, you know, comics that they had ordered.
And that brings me to another point on how to grade your comics. First edition, second edition.
First printing.
Yeah, first printing.
Now here's the thing, getting into the Death of Superman, just because that is a key issue, doesn't make it worth money.
Right. It was in the day when they were selling out, but now
what makes the comic
Death of Superman is a dime a dozen.
Yeah, you can pick that up, bagged or unbagged. There were multiple prints. I think there were like five, at least, I think it was like at least five printings of the, four or five printings of that issue. So it's so easy to come by. And what happened was so many people said, oh, Superman's dying. So they bought up literally a stack of them, thinking later on down the road they were going to be worth so much money. And is that still filming?
Yeah.
Okay. They thought they were going to be worth so much money. And I get people coming in here going, I have the first, you know, the Death of Superman. And I hate to tell them that a lot of times
and how
that
you
book's can, worth anywhere from $3 to $18 most of the time.
And how you can tell if it is a first printing, second printing, or whatever, is on, for, let's say this was the Death of Superman. There would be a Roman numeral, like I've got a fourth printing at home, so there would be a Roman numeral 4, IV, right here next under the number.
Of that particular
right.
issue. Now, they don't really do that anymore. So what they would do now to check is you open your book up. I'm going to put the camera here. And you would go to the, where the hell's the copyright page?
The copyright page is a little tricky to find at times because it's either on the back of the cover or it's on like the first, one of the first three pages.
You want to look, there we go, at the copyright. Now it's going to say somewhere in here, whether it's first printing, second printing. Now if you don't see the words first printing or second printing, then chances are that it is a first print.
If it's a second or third print, it will say first print, second print, third print.
Which I'm trying to find in here.
Look in the dollar books. That's what you're like, looking for comparison. We have somebody calling. Their phone number pop up there.
It was one of those block numbers that still shows up. And also, issue number ones are a dime a dozen as well.
Yo, yeah. Of what?
Of anything.
Not really.
Well,
you find me a Superman number one. Then.
True. Well, it depends on which Superman. New 52 Superman number one.
You find me the originals of the Superman number one, or maybe Spider-Man number one.
That's true.
So yeah.
But just because it says issue number one does not make it worth money.
I had a book in here that I also recommend reading, by the way. It's called Mort, the Dead Teenager. I read it, by the way. It's hilarious. But this book, nobody's ever heard of Mort, the Dead Teenager. It was done by Marvel in 1993, I believe. Maybe 97. But nobody's heard of this. And case in point, it was a four-issue miniseries, and it bombed big time. So that book, you bring that in, number one. It's a number one issue. Guess what? That book is worth maybe a buck.
What you really want to look for is key issues. Like this one. This would be the first appearance of Tim Drake outside of the Robin costume, correct?
I don't think so. I had that over here. And I sold them.
This is one of the first appearances.
This is one of the books. It's kind of a key issue. It's Tim Drake, the second Robin. He's
the third Robin.
Third Robin. I knew that. Put it away. That's something else too. You'll learn a lot of different people have portrayed a lot of known characters. There's been a couple of Batman. There's been multiple Robins. There's been a few different Spider-Man.
And yeah, something that can take a very popular, very expensive comic and make it plummet is if that comic had featured the death of a character in it, and then they bring that character back to life, that comic is no longer worth much.
No, not as much as it was.
Right. It's still considered the
case in point, the death of Jason Todd and the death in the family storyline of Batman. It's still a fairly pricey issue. I've had it in here a few times, but it would have been even more had it been in better condition and had they not brought the character back a decade later.
And the reason it's still an expensive issue is because it's a key issue. It actually it's what that character is based around now.
Yeah. Again, if you go on comicpriceguide.com, and it's a site you'll have to sign up. It's free. Once you sign up, you can look up multiple books, as many as you want, without, you know, being a member. Excuse me. If it's a key issue, it'll actually tell you if it's a key issue or not and why it's a key issue. So, if it's the first appearance of a character, I'll say first appearance of.
And something else I want to mention real quick, it's kind of comic book related, kind of not, is action figures. If you're getting into collecting action figures, this is another thing you need to look for.
This should be another episode.
We'll kind of
action figures
hint at it here, but
coming soon.
Sherlock. You wouldn't think it'd be too expensive.
And these new John's
got a $50 price tag on it.
Now this figure normally goes for about $20. This was Toys R Us is where I got it at.
However, the packaging, he was packaged.
And he didn't open the package, he just opened a little, had a little display window.
Packaged upside down. So that's what makes him more valuable.
I've had figures with paint apps that were supposed to be included, but not. I've had figures with two left arms attached instead of one left and one right.
Stephanie McMahon, which has no painted underwear on.
No, that my WWF Heat action figure that I have here in store was painted with no underwear on.
Yes, he did say WWF because it came out before
WWE logo.
Right.
Don't ask how I had to figure that out. Let's just say I got caught by a Walmart employee looking up Stephanie McMahon's dress. But that figure, one of the reasons why that figure is unique is because not only was it a paint app mistake, like she didn't have underwear painted under her skirt, is it was recalled because of that. Most of these figures, they're not recalled. Mm-hmm. They're just sent out, like, okay, stop production until we fix it, then send more out. This one was actually recalled.
Do you think she was probably a little embarrassed when she heard about that?
I think she was scanned that way. Because let's face it, Stephanie McMahon's got some. Anywho, I don't want to get beat up by Triple H. I actually heard she's a really nice person.
Yeah.
In real life, though.
She was a very gorgeous woman when she first debuted in WWF.
She still is. She's still very. Yeah. I mean,
the attitude kind of makes that plummet, but.
Yeah. I mean, that's not her real attitude.
I know, it's kind of hard not to look at her and not see that attitude.
And again, these are things that I will be discussing on my new live podcast. I'll be appearing on Facebook here probably next month. I'll shoot for this month. Probably next month. I'm looking for a new co-host. Shannon doesn't watch wrestling, or he would be joining. But yeah, I'll be going over Raw, SmackDown. We're going over 205 Live, NXT, hopefully Ring of Honor, TNA.
The pay-per-views.
So, I mean, check it out. The title of the show is The Pit. So, it'll take place probably, I think, on Thursdays. Is what I'm shooting for at 2 o'clock. So, I'll be live, Facebook exclusive. So, hit me up.
All right, we'll be back next week with some more Comicgeddon. Have fun, guys.
Hey guys, if you like this video, make sure you hit that like button, maybe put a comment below, and hit that subscribe button.
And be sure to head on over to our Facebook page. Links are in the description below.